your word. Thank you for this amazing body. I continue to declare over them, over this church, that we are a strong body. We are a strong body. We know how to wield the sword of the Spirit. We have the strength to pick up that sword and to wield it well, with precision, with the precision guided by the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord God. We are a strong body that knows how to be active and to hear your voice, and we acknowledge you as our commander, Lord, our King Jesus, and we follow you every step of the way, through every moment of our day. And we will engage as you call us to engage. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, you are Lord. Thank you, Lord God, for this word. Help me to articulate your heart, to extrapolate from your word, and to present well. In Jesus' name. Thank you for helping me sing that last song a little bit. I needed a little, I think I caught the tune a little better as you helped me. To start it off, I will acknowledge that was really rough. But I think I caught it. I think I did. Anyways, thanks for following our lead, and we just want to go deeper in the presence of the Lord. I want to continue there as we go into the Word today. Church family, for the last 3-4 years, the Lord has called us up. And a word that the Lord gave me this last week was, we have been somewhat of a militia, but it is time to join the army. There's strength when we come under a general. There's strength when we come under an admiral. There's strength when we join the army. God has called us to engage in big things these last 4 years. And as we have done so, at different points, I think, I'm gonna speak humbly, I think, we have led you well into those bigger things, those bigger engagements in the spiritual realm, even things that have had physical ramifications. I believe we've led you well into those things. But I do acknowledge that there's a possibility that we haven't always led into big things very well. I think we did a good job as we led and we revealed the Father's heart as we, let's just make a list of some of the things we've done. Like, our stance and our approach to COVID, that was really big. More recently, with the Drag Queen Story Hour, we've just done some bigger, we've engaged some bigger things. And last week, I led the church into, as I really felt the Lord was telling me to do so, a very specific and strategic time for Israel. This is a big thing. It's another big thing. And as I look back and evaluated that moment, I want to admit to you that I don't think I led into it well. I think we still were productive. I think it was good. We did what... But I acknowledge I could have done it better at leading you into the moment. And in doing that, I mean, I could have done better as to answering the why. Why do we do this? Why are we doing this? Why did we step out and do the Jericho walk? Why did we step out around the mall? And why did we step out and do the stance against the Drag Queen Story Hour? Why did we stand the way we did with COVID. I think we've done, we communicated, but in that moment, last Sunday, I don't feel that, I felt I could have done better at communicating the why. And maybe I should have preached this sermon, which I didn't have then, so it is what it is, but maybe we should have preached this sermon and then done the prayer. Because it's important that we understand why. Like, when we go into a corporate time of prayer like we did last Sunday against something or for something, a specific thing that's happening in our culture and in our world, we are engaging in spiritual battle that is so significant. And if we don't understand our why, then we start, what we do is we start flailing our sword. Our sword doesn't cut with as effective a swing as it could, because we don't totally know the why. And let's be honest, if we look at the media and the way that it, and I think we did talk about this ever so slightly last week before we prayed, but it was a small amount of time we took for this. The media is steering, the reason why I'm addressing, I'm bringing this up again, because this is a major world event, and we are a church that engages what's happening in the world. We don't put our head in the sand. We're not going to just stand by and let the world happen. We're going to stand with Jesus and engage the Father's heart and do what he's doing. And the media is certainly telling us many different things. An example would be this last week, how very quickly, I think it was Tuesday or Monday, we heard about the hospital that was bombed in Gaza, and very quickly the media said, well, that was from Israel, and Israel did that. And they killed 500 people, and doctors and children and all of that, right? But then the very next day, it flip-flopped, didn't it? Right? All the retractions from New York Times and all the MSNBC, they all retracted, and they all said, oh, wait, our own president of the United States says it wasn't even from Israel. It was a rogue rocket from Hamas. Right? Like, if we don't understand, or if we are engaging, because there's a physical battle going on, but our role is spiritual, and if we don't understand the spiritual battle, if we don't understand what's happening, and if all we're getting is from earthly sources, it's going to be a mess. It's going to be a muddy mess. And in part, that's why I took the stance I did last week, and I was pretty firm. I used some pretty strong language with regards to the direction of our prayer time. I admit that was stronger than I usually use. But I wanted to clear the water. I wanted to draw the line. But see, how do we draw the line on any matter in life? How do we draw the line, guys? We draw the line with the Word of God. And so last week, I led you into a significant time, and we took significant time in our service to pray for Israel. But I could have done better at telling you the why. And the why is in the Word. We had on the screen, we stand with Israel. In light of all that is the news, and in light of however people's personal stances on war, in my personal heritage, my grandfather was on the front lines in France. And I've told you this. Inside my very soul, this may be why I like hunting so much, is because there's a warrior in me that wants, like, I told you how when I was 18, I sat my parents down and I said, I'm going to join the army. And they said, no, my dad wouldn't let me because of what he saw his dad go through in the PTSD and stuff. But it's still a level of me. Like, when I see those troops jump out of planes, I'm I'm one of those guys that yells, hoorah! Like, that's how I am, like, when I'm watching a YouTube video and I see that. Like, yeah. Flex the muscles I don't have. Pastor Mel talked about my muscles last week in his sermon. I'm like, looking at my arms, I'm going, I don't see my... Could look at somebody else here around the room. And when we look at the events of this world, this is how we draw the line. This is how we determine what side of the line we're on. And so in one regard, I want to humble myself further and apologize. I could have done a better job of leading us into that moment. I led us into a spiritual battle that I didn't help you have your armor on well enough. Because there's going to be more spiritual battles. And so I want to commit to you as your pastor and Heather and Pastor Mel and Nelson, we're going to do a better job of telling you the why through the word. Because that's how we draw the line in the sand. On all of these major cultural and physical events and realities of our world, this is how we know how to move. Somebody say amen. Because that's a sermon in and of itself, and I haven't even started preaching yet. My chair behind me because I feel like I might need to sit. We'll see. Like I said, I'm going to preach long today. So thank you for your grace. It is my heart to not shy away from the things that is happening in the world. It is my heart to hold forth the torch of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is my heart to preach the word of God in grace and truth. So, I don't know if I finished this sentence. Sometimes I get a little jumbled in my brain a little bit. I want to verbalize an apology of that I didn't do as good as I should have. And I will do better. I will do better. I'm going to say, just be more clear, please forgive me. And we're going to do this better. So let me take some time and tell you why Yorkton Family Worship Center stands with Jesus, stands with Israel. We stand with Jesus. Let me tell you why we stand with Israel. And it does not have anything to do with the conflict currently. Although there will be some possible moments where I might say something in regards to it. In fact, there will be one moment where I will say something, I'm sure. But it might not be in my notes. So I want to go through four things today to help us understand the why. Number one, God has chosen Israel. Number two, God loves Israel. Number three, an attack against Israel is an attack against God. And number four, God still has a plan for Israel. So in these four things, I'm going to try to tell you the why we stand with Israel, even in light of all that is, and even in light of the brutality of war. So number one, God chose Israel. You need to get your Bibles out and get yourself into Genesis, starting in chapter 12. Bibles out, Genesis chapter 12 is where we'll start. I'm going to read a few things and we're going to get into there in a second. The scripture is quite clear that among all the nations of the world, God chose Israel as the one he would work with. God said through the prophet Isaiah, "Yet hear now, O Jacob, my servant, that Israel, and Jacob, my servant, and Israel, whom I have chosen." Isaiah 44, verse 1. This was the nation that God delivered out of slavery in Egypt, the nation to whom God gave the land Canaan, and the nation through whom God, through whom Jesus, the Messiah, came. Was there something special about Israel? There is something special about Israel. And God himself answers this statement or addresses this in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 and 8. We're going to get to Genesis in a moment. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 and 8 reads this. "For you are a holy people," that's Israel, "to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the people." Above all. You see the separation? Even right there we see the separation. "Above all the other people, above all the peoples in the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love on you nor choose you because you were more in number than any other people. For you were the least of all peoples. But because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep the oath which he swore to your fathers," that's Abraham, we'll get there in a moment, "the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt." The Lord has chosen you to be the people for himself, a special treasure, a special treasure. We can apply that to the next point of how God loves Israel. He sees Israel as a special treasure. Let me just talk about this whole reality of Israel being chosen above all other people groups in the earth. We go to Genesis chapter 12. We see this moment of Abram, no kids. God makes a covenant with Abram. And this is Abram who has his name changed by God to Abraham, right? Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. A very familiar passage of scripture, especially in these last few weeks, has been quoted a lot. "I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you." And that blessing of being blessed through Israel is by Jesus, right? So there's no kids. But it's obvious there's going to be some kids. Genesis chapter 15. "After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless?" And then we see, now we're going to really focus in Genesis 16 and 17. "Now Sarah, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. In that culture and in that time, it is not the heart of the Lord for now, hear me clearly, but in that moment and time, the appropriate action to carry on the family lineage was if the wife was not able to have children, then the wife would give her maidservant to be a wife, another wife, wife number two. Not appropriate, not the father's heart, but in that context, culturally, that's what they did to carry on. And so Hagar becomes a wife. Sarai gives, who soon becomes Sarah, gives Hagar to Abram. And says, have kids through her so that our lineage can continue. She did become pregnant. The scripture says in verse 4 of 16, she knew that she was impregnant, that she was pregnant, and she despised her mistress. So Hagar began to have bad relations with Sarai. And in this moment, Sarai and Abraham have a conversation, and Sarai says, I'm going to get rid of them. And Abram says, do what you want with your slave. She kicks her out. And the angel of the Lord meets with her, sends her back. It says this. Then the angel of the Lord says, go back to your mistress and submit to her. The angel added, I will increase your descendants so much. And she's still just pregnant, right? I will increase your descendants so much that you will be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord said to her, you are now pregnant, Mrs. Key. You will give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael. For the Lord has heard your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will, okay, hear this. His hand will be against him. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him. And he will live in hostility towards all his brothers. Now we pick it up in chapter 17. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Abram fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is verse 4 of chapter 17, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. You got to hear this. You got to read this carefully. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. A covenant is made with Abraham. Now we go to verse 15. God is now speaking again to Abraham. God also said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name is Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give her a son. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of people will come from her. Abraham has a laugh. He says, like, we're too old. Verse 19 says, then God said, yes, but your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will call him Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him, and an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard you. I will surely bless him. I will make him fruitful and will greatly increase his numbers. He will be the father of 12 rulers, and I will make him a great nation. But, okay, verse 21, everybody say the word but. But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you by this time next year. When he had finished speaking to Abraham, God went up from him. Church family, there's a difference between a blessing and a covenant. God heard Hagar, thank you. God heard Hagar, and in his great mercy, extended a blessing to her. Care for Ishmael. But God also heard Sarah, or Sarai, King Sarah and Abraham. And there's a difference. He blessed Ishmael, but he made a covenant with Isaac. We see in chapter 21 that the struggles continued in the home, and that's why one man, one woman, till death do they part, right? This is, in the time frame, Ishmael is now 14 years old, or 16 years old. He's 16, I think, and Isaac is now 2, so there's 14 years difference, and Ishmael is mocking and kind of being a bully to Isaac. And so Sarah says, like, be gone with you. But God said to him, now this matter, verse 11, now this matter distressed Abraham greatly because of his concern for his son, Ishmael. But God said to him, do not be distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. Isaac, Isaac, Isaac. Isaac is the father of Jacob, whose name is changed to, after he wrestled with God that night, God renamed him to Israel. Oh. Do you see? There's a difference between Israel and everybody else. God chose them above all other people. Through those people, through the people of Israel, he would have his son Jesus come to earth as the Messiah for all people. Yes. But let's acknowledge that through this one very special group of people, the apple of God's eye, the scripture says, Israel. Israel is the nation that has a covenant, an everlasting covenant with God. So that's why, that's in part why we realize, and this is a layer of our support, our love for Israel. Do we support everything that Israel does? No. Do they love and honor Jesus right now? No, they don't. But we're going to get to that in my fourth point. God chose Israel. This is the first layer of our understanding of why we support Israel. Number two, God loves Israel. This point will go pretty fast. 1 Kings chapter 10, verse 9 reads, blessed be the Lord your God who delights in you to set you on the throne of Israel, because the Lord loved Israel forever. Therefore, he made you king to do justice and righteousness. Hosea chapter 11, verse 1, when Israel was a youth, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called him. Zechariah chapter 2, verse 8, I already mentioned this briefly, but this is where the scripture, the prophet declares Israel to be the apple of God's eye. Romans chapter 11, we've been in the Old Testament, now Romans chapter 11, New Testament, chapter 11, verse 28. From the standpoint of the gospel, they are enemies, right? I just told you, Israel is not following Jesus. They're not saved. They need to be saved. There are remnant, there are people, there is a remnant, there are Jewish people who are Christians. For the standpoint of the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. But from the standpoint of God's choice, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers. Jesus said in Luke chapter 23, verse 34, and this kind of hit me between the eyes. Hit me in the heart, if you will. We know from that Jesus, he's up on the cross. He's paying the price for sin for all mankind. And as he declares the words, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing," we understand that it is our sin, it's my sin, it's your sin that held him there. We get that. And so we understand, we appreciate the declaration from the cross that Jesus gives that says, "I forgive you. There's grace for you." We appreciate that, don't we? But can we not also understand, or can we not just take a look through, like just look through the eyes of Jesus, and who was he looking at? Israel. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." What love God has for Israel. What love he has for Israel. Now, number three, this one will take a little longer. An attack against Israel is an attack against God. As the Israelites moved closer to the promised land, as recorded in the latter half of the book of Numbers, they continued to run into roadblocks. They continued to run into, like, they would approach kings and they would say, "Can we pass through peacefully? We won't even drink any water. We won't eat anything from your fields. Nothing. We won't touch them. We'll stay on the road." And these armies would go, "Oh, no. No, no, no. You can't do that." And they found themselves in battle after battle and victory after victory. And their reputation as a nation to not be trifled with preceded them. And then there came Balak, the king of Moab. He saw the Israelites on their borders, and he was concerned. He's like, "Everybody else has been defeated. What am I going to do? How am I going to beat these people? I can't beat these people. These are slaves out of Egypt who are not trained, yet they have something about them that is causing them to win every battle. Like, do they even have swords? We don't even know." Right? Like, and still, every battle they met, every battle they finished with victory. And Balak, he's like, this is going to be bad for us. You know, he could have just said, "You know, like everybody else, I'll give you," everybody else said no, "but I'll give you permission to go through your land. Go through the land. You go. Just go through peacefully." But he didn't. He started, because battle was battle, and this was kind of the trend, he took up arms, and he's going, "How am I going to defeat them?" And he realized he was smart. He said, "This is not a physical battle. This is a spiritual battle. I need to go against their God. You hear me? This is really good here, guys." Balak says, "I can't touch the people. I'm going to go after their God." So what did he do? He grabs some guy with a talking donkey. Remember? Balaam? The crooked prophet. He's called a prophet of God, but he was crooked. He could be paid off. No prophet of God that can be paid off is no prophet of God, I'll tell you that. God tries to get his attention through talking through his donkey. Anyways, he wouldn't have it, and he was more engrossed with the gold he'd get from Balak. So he went on. Balak employs Balaam to curse Israel, because if he can't get them physically, he's going to get them spiritually. So the moment comes when Balaam is supposed to curse Israel. And he says this. It starts in verse 7 of Numbers chapter 23. Balak brought me, that's Balaam, from Aram, the king of Moab, from the eastern mountains. Come, he said, curse Jacob for me. Come, denounce Israel. How can I curse? Verse 8, how can I curse those whom God has not cursed? How can I denounce those whom the Lord has not denounced? From the rocky peaks I see them. From the heights I view them. I see people who live apart and do not consider themselves one of the nations, who can count the dust of Jacob or number even the fourth of Israel. Let me die the death of the righteous, and may my final end be like theirs. Balak said to Balaam, What have you done? I brought you to curse you, to curse my enemies, but you have done nothing but bless them. He answered, Must I not speak what the Lord puts in my mouth? Must I not speak what the Lord puts in my mouth? And here's the point. A fight against Israel is a fight against God. In the Garden of Eden, Israel did not exist. The devil's problem was with the Creator God, who is the God of Israel, who is our God. And how do you come against the Creator God? By destroying that which is his chosen people, Israel. Why is there such a battle against Israel? You know, we can go back in history and we say, well, Israel did this and Israel did that, and there's this and there's that and there's this, and we can point fingers. But why is there an issue with Israel? Why would the descendants of Ishmael be all over Israel? Why? You got to read to the end of the Bible. You got to read. You can't just read the first half. You got to read the whole Bible. You got to read it all. In the book of Zechariah, the second last book in the Old Testament, we'll get to Revelation in a moment. Zechariah chapter 14, verses 4 through 11 reads this. And in that day, his feet will stand, that's Jesus, will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall be split in two from east to west, making a very large valley. Half the mountains shall move towards the north, and half towards the south. Then they shall flee through my mountain valley, for the mountain valley shall reach Ezel. Yes, you shall flee. Yes, or as you fled from the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Thus the Lord my God will come, and all the saints with you. I shall come to pass in that. It shall come to pass in that day that there will be no light. The lights will diminish. It shall be one day which is known to the Lord, neither day or night, but at evening time it shall happen that it will be light. And in that day it shall be that living waters shall flow from Jerusalem, half of them towards the eastern sea and half of them towards the western sea. In both summer and winter it shall occur, and the Lord shall be the king over the earth. In that day it shall be the Lord is one. His name is one. Now if you go to Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 through 16, I'm just going to read it from. Revelation chapter 19. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with robes dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. That's Jesus. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of the mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with an iron rod. He himself treads the winepress and the fierceness of wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In chapter 20, we see this all walked out where, and specifically, I'm going to just jump ahead a little bit, verses 7 through 10 of chapter 20, the devil is cast away into hell, and there he will remain. Praise the Lord. Why is there a fight against Israel? Because it is Israel where Jesus will come and stand on the Mount of Olives and establish his kingdom forever. That is why there is a fight over the land. And that is why we must stand with Israel. Do we not realize that it's a losing battle right now for Israel? Right now it's a lose-lose battle. If they fight, in the Western world, we all condemn them. Because they're going to battle, they're going to war, they're defending, I don't know if anybody, well, maybe people did, I don't know. But, you know, when 9/11 happened, I remember a bit of a hoorah gathering with the armies. You know, like you just killed, was it close to 3,000 people? And, I mean, all the news agencies have said, this is like Israel's 9/11. Only it's the equivalent, if you put the population against each other, it's the equivalent of Israel losing 40,000 people. I think is what I read. If they fight, they lose because everybody cancels them because they're bad. If they don't fight, then Hamas and everybody else, and let me tell you what, this is a spiritual thing. I've been listening to sermons all week long. I've been trying to give you something here because I needed to learn. I needed to understand. I needed to be able to vocalize and verbalize the why to you. And as I've been listening to whys, and I'm being very careful with who I'm listening to, I'm hearing this, there's a spirit of Hamas. There's a spirit called Hamas. In the land back when Noah, when all the bad, when the world was a mess, it was a spirit of Hamas that was causing that. This is a spirit that has, and I'll tell you what, as the news I've been watching, there was different attack points that were mounting up with soldiers and with different artillery and such to attack Israel. And Hamas jumped the gun, I think by the Lord. They had enough artillery. They had enough armies if they had all gone in one swoop to take out at least 10,000 people. But because Hamas jumped the gun because they wanted the glory, they wanted, look what we did, they only were able to take out 1,000 or 1,200, whatever it was. The devil doesn't want Israel to exist. It's not just Iran. Iran has been, like, for as long as I can remember as a teen, like, from as long as I've been paying attention to news, I've heard it forever. I'm 42 years old. Iran wants to eradicate Israel. As Hitler tried, Iran's picked it up. Why? Because if there's no Israel, then God can't come, and the devil can't be cast into the sea forever. Why do you think the devil's after it? Because he wants to be king forever. So he's like, well, I'm going to do my best to just remove Israel from the face of the earth. Because if there's no Israel, then if there's no Mount of Olives, then Jesus can't come. Why is there such a battle against Israel? It's because the devil doesn't want Because the devil wants to reign and he doesn't want God to reign. And so this is all part of it, understanding why we support Israel, why we stand with Israel, why we pray for peace. Psalm chapter 22, chapter 122, it says, pray for the peace of Israel. This is why we stand with Israel. And I know there's people on all over the world, and there's people on both sides of the front of the battle that love Jesus. And oh, it's such a mess. It's such a mess. And so we can pray. We can pray for all the believers. We can pray for, like, I actually appreciated political lines aside. I appreciate one interview that I watched with Trump, with President Trump, former President Trump. They said to him, what would you do with Ukraine? And he communicated, he said, his idea was, what he communicated, and this is, I'm not getting it right exactly, but you're going to get the heartbeat. He said, I just don't want anybody to die. I'm going to stop Ukraine. I'm going to stop Russia. Like, oh yeah, the question was, what side are you on? I'm not on either side. I just want all the killing to stop. And yes, we want all the killing to stop. We don't want this mess of Palestinian people being used as human shields against Israel. That's what's happening in Gaza. Israel tried, get out of the way so we can go to battle. We need to defend ourselves. Get out of the way, civilians. Get out of the way. And what did they do? What did Hamas do? They blocked their way. There's only two exits, I think. And they blocked the way. And I've heard reports how Hamas has ammunition depots and stuff underneath hospitals and schools. And it's all human shield stuff. It's just, it's hideous. It's demonic. It's demonic. It's demonic. The devil is trying to kill and destroy Israel because he doesn't want Jesus to come back as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. If the Mount of Olives isn't there, if and even if the people of Israel get wiped off the map, then it discredits God. And it removes the severity of the Word of God. It removes the strength of the Word of God if Israel gets killed off. So, a fight against Israel is a fight against God. I hope you got that. My last teaching point is God has a plan for Israel. God has a plan for Israel. Now, don't hear what I'm not saying. I am being very specific. I'm talking about Israel. I didn't say that God doesn't have a plan for everybody else, because he has a plan for you and me, so obviously he has a plan for everybody else. We know the blood of Jesus, it covers, it was shed for the sins of the whole world. And we know that that the Father's heart in the book of I think it's 2 Samuel, that none would perish, but all would come to know Jesus. And he's devising ways to draw all men to himself, right? Like, we know the Father's heart. But I'm talking about Israel today. So don't get that meshed together and go, like, don't hear what I'm not saying. If I look around the room and I go, 90% of you have been under my teaching for the last 5, 6, 7, some of you 8 years, you know that I believe, and you know that the Bible teaches that God is for all people. But in this moment, we got to talk about Israel. Because this is an issue that needs to be talked about. You know, churches, we can very easily put our head in the sand. I could have preached from Matthew chapter 20. I got my sermon pretty much, like, I could teach it. If I could continue in that sermon series pretty easy. Probably pick it up next week, I would think, maybe. We can put our head in the sand with this, you guys, but that's not us, is it? We're a strong warrior church, aren't we? We go to battle for the Lord. We fight against the devil's schemes. We are not shy to this. We're not oblivious to the devil's schemes. We are aware of them, and we fight against them with the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay. Here we go. Last point. Thank you guys for staying with me. This won't take long. God still has a plan of salvation for the Jews. Are they right now in a place of salvation? If they don't acknowledge Jesus, then no. If they don't acknowledge Jesus as Savior and Lord, then no. If they do, then they're saved. But God has a plan for the Jews, for the nation of Israel. If we go back to Israel's journey through the desert towards the promised land, there was no time when they were completely appreciative of God and his care. Yes, they celebrated what God did in the different moments. When they crossed the Red Sea, they sang and danced, and they celebrated. When the Lord provided, they celebrated. They were thankful. But they did not consistently trust God and constantly trust God. In all of that journey with Israel, that did not change God's heart. In this moment, they are not following, they're not in salvation. But this has not changed the Father's heart towards Israel. Remember, this is an everlasting covenant based on Abraham, not based on current Israel. This is based, did you hear what I just said? That is huge. That is like amen worthy. Oh, you guys, did you catch it? The severity of what I just said is huge, you guys. That exemplifies the everlasting faithfulness of our God. He made a promise. He made a promise. And he keeps it. Are they following Jesus? But because of that promise, he's a promise keeper, you guys. Because of that promise, he's keeping it. And he has a plan. And he has a plan. And he's outlined it where? In his word. Oh, you guys, stick close to the Bible. Anytime you got to draw a line in the sand, draw it with the word. Draw it with the word. Oh, praise the Lord. Okay. Where did I pick up? I've said it all already. Jesus. Okay, I need you to hear this clearly. God's plans for Israel are big plans that have eternal significance. Jesus identified himself as the prophesied Davidic king who would restore Israel in Acts chapter 3, verses 19 through 22. The Jews rejected him, as foretold by Isaiah 52, chapter 52 and 53. Jesus instructed his disciples to spread the good news of all to all nations, fulfilling Abraham's mission to bless the nations, right? God blesses the whole world through Israel, through Jesus. Now hear me. Replacement theology suggests the church took over Israel's role in God's plans. This belief is incorrect. It implies that God is finished with Israel and that he broke his promise to Abraham and David. However, as I've already said it, God is not a promise breaker. He's a promise keeper. Praise the Lord. The hardening, the disbelief in the Messiah of Israel is neither complete nor permanent. It's neither complete, because there's a remnant, or is it permanent? Some Israelites still have faith, and this state will continue until the fullness of the Gentiles comes to pass. Romans chapter 11, verse 25. You want to read Romans chapter 11, verse the latter half of Romans chapter 11. That's really good in regards to this. Eventually, all of Israel will find salvation. Romans chapter 11, verse 26. God will instill in the house of David a spirit of grace, leading them to mourn the one they pierced. Zechariah 12, 10. That is to say, their hard heart, by the grace of God, will be softened, and they will come to Jesus. God has a plan for Israel. God has a plan for Israel. Right now, the world would say, the Western world, a lot of the Western world would say, do away with Israel. They're storming. Do you guys see how they entered the capital in the States? And they protested in favor of Palestine? And they didn't do anything, did they? I'm just pointing out some hypocrisy here in my political mindset of Trump and everything and the devil's schemes of how far things go left and how far things go right. My goodness, you guys. Let's just even just emphasize how far things go left. Oh. The anti-Semitism root against Israel is deep right now. And I would dare say it is the church's job. It is the church's job to hold forth the word of God, the Bible, and uproot that evil thing in this nation and declare God still has a plan for Israel. That's like 1 hour on the dot. Praise the Lord. Oh, church family. I don't know where this is going to go. Nobody knows in terms of, you know, there's generals and there's admirals and there's the leaders of nations that are doing things all over the world right now. It's a big melting pot of terrible ramifications. Lord God, bring peace. But in all of this, we need to remain. Not because we're picking sides on the battle, you guys. Like, that's not actually it. We're picking sides with the Word of God. Okay? Why do we stand with Israel? Because God stands with Israel. And His Word of, and I've done my best to show you the why today. If I had done this last week, we wouldn't have had time to pray. Oh, praise the Lord. Plus, Pastor Mel had to bring his good word. That was really good last week. Do you understand the why? Do you see the why? If I could do any, if I could do, you know, they have those pens now that you can draw in the air, and they can do on the screen, and there's even those things where you draw in the air and this plastic comes out, and you can, if I could do that with my Bible, I would spell out W-H-Y. This is the why. Why do we stand with Jesus? Why do we stand with Israel? Because the Bible shows us that God stands with Israel and we stand with God. And so as the melting pot and struggles and issues ensue, pray for all people. And last week, there was a specific thing that was happening. It was a specific corporate act. But God might be calling you singularly to pray for it, for other things. Do that. Do that. But I'll tell you what, when it comes to these corporate gatherings, I seek the Lord for the specific, for where he wants to strike. And so there's lots of room to pray in many directions and to even support in many directions. But don't do it at the expense of Israel. Pray for Israel. Stand with Israel. Praise the Lord. I've done my best. I leave it with you and the Lord. Why don't you stand with me? I need to have a quick little confab with my brother Brian here. Why don't you stand for a moment, and then I'll come back and pray. It's 12:35. I want to pray. We're going to close the service. But we have our ministry team is available. Brian and Raylene Preber are ready to pray with people. And I just had a little conversation with Brian because I wanted, is there anything the Lord is highlighting to him and or to Raylene about any extra layer of ministry? And so if you're here today, one of the things they feel highlighted is, and we prayed about this, we did effectively pray, like this is, but if there's more work to be done in this way, in this area, if you're feeling chained up, maybe by sin, maybe by an addiction, maybe by a relational issue that's just got your, you feel bound in some way, they feel led to pray specifically in those areas. And so if that's you, come and find Brian and Raylene up at the front here, and they'll minister to you. Any other issue as well, any other thing, like the Lord wants to touch it all. The Lord wants to heal it all and do it all. And so they're open, but the Lord has highlighted that specific theme of if you're in bondage, if you're in chains, come forward. The Lord wants to set you free. So come and receive prayer this morning if you need it. Lord God, we thank you. We thank you, Jesus, for coming through the line of Israel. Thank you, Lord God. Jesus, you are our God. You're our Lord. And you save even us, Gentiles. You save us, Gentiles. People outside of Israel. And you've made a covenant with us. Thank you, Lord. We will serve you. We will follow you. We will love you forever. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, we do pray for Israel. And as Psalm 122 instructs us to pray for peace in Israel, we do pray for peace in Israel. We pray, Lord God, that the battle would the resolve would happen, that there would be a resolve. There would be a resolve. And we pray, Lord God, for the protection of life. In Jesus' name. Lord God, we bless Israel. We acknowledge that Israel alone is your choice. Like they are your special treasure. And as people that are grafted into the family of God, it is our heart that Israel, well, Lord, just speed up the time frame because they need you to. Lord God, it feels like you're coming anytime. Come, Lord Jesus, come. We're ready for you to come, to stand on that Mount of Olives to establish your kingdom. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Lord God, we bless Israel. And we acknowledge that you have a plan for them, that you chose them, that you love them. And because you love them, because you chose them, because you have a plan for them, we choose them. We love them. Lord God, save Israel. Establish your kingdom. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy is the name of the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Church, you're amazing, and I thank you for your grace. I thank you, Lord God, or I thank you, church, for sticking with me today. Today was a big word. Hope you have some steps forward as we move forward in this world. Bless you. Love you lots. Love you lots.